So I'm just going to start with before I introduce our special guest participants, with just a minute or two commentary that over the last year, we've really had in the state a great deal of discussion about workforce education, workforce development, bridging the two. In the gubernatorial election last year, both leading candidates really had workforce education at the top of their agenda. This session, actually before the session started, Governor DeSantis had issued an executive order on workforce education, Executive Order 19-31, really laying out a plan for the state for things like including apprenticeships and increasing the connection between K-12 and higher ed certificates and workforce. There was one particular large omnibus workforce education bill that went through the legislature that is HB 7071 that included creating for the first time a statutory attainment goal, post-secondary attainment goal, which is 60% by 2030, and that 60% of the working age population in our state, ages 25 to 64, that they should have some form of an associate's degree, bachelor's degree, or an industry high-quality certification that would prepare them to be able to work and thrive in the economy in the near future. It also included in this bill apprenticeships and pre-apprenticeship programs, and a lot of new information about something called the Sail to 60 initiative, which is going to implement that post-secondary attainment goal. Transforming the former Higher Education Coordinating Council into a Florida Talent Development Council that's responsible for implementing that goal in the future towards 2030. So that bill has not yet reached the governor, but it passed unanimously through both houses. Very bipartisan. When it gets to the governor, given that it implements most of what was in his executive order, it's assumed that he'll be signing that fairly soon. So that is just to say that in the course of the past year, there's been a lot of discussion and also some action on workforce education and workforce development. And today we want to talk a little bit more about what is workforce development, what's the state of it in Florida, where do we need to go from here? How is it, where does the state need to go, and what's frankly the role for Florida Tax Watch in this issue? So with me today, I've got four special guests that we're going to call on for comments, but it's also up to you as well to be contributing to the conversation. So we're going to start over to my far left with Greg Hale, who is the 7th president of Broward College, one of the jewels in our Florida college system. We also have here Marshall Kreiser, who many of us know from over the years, our chancellor of the Florida University System. Our friend Ken Lawson, who is our new executive director of the Florida Department of Economic Opportunity, previously president and CEO of Visit Florida, also previously the secretary of Florida Department of Business and Professional Regulation.
I can't keep a job,
right? And then last, we've got Tim Vandenhoof, the senior vice president of business development for Enterprise Florida, who's very involved in retaining and expanding our existing and targeted industries and bringing them into Florida, attracting new business investment into the state. So I'm going to start with the question of how do we define workforce development in 2019? And Ken,
I'll say from my standpoint, the practical sense, it's fine. I don't get ready for the future. On two ends, when I was a secretary of EPR, went down to a pharmaceutical company. And their biggest complaint was that they couldn't find people who were ready to work in their multi-billion dollar facility. And this week I traveled to the state board to career source board offices. And you have folks who barely finish high school, right at the lower end of the spectrum, trying to engage, get a job. So when we're talking about development, is making sure that, across the board, that individuals who are here to state of Florida have the skill set and awareness of what it takes to work in order to earn money, build a home, have a family, and participate, and have people ready to build these businesses that haven't been created yet, can use their skills and imagination. You know, it's like in Star Trek, Kobayashi Maru. It's not a no-win situation, but it's a situation where you put our heads together and really become clear of your direction and work with government, business, and education to ensure that people are able to grow and go their path. So,
I would agree with Director Lawson, obviously, but I think the biggest thing is it's always evolving. So what it looks like in 19 is not what it's going to look like in 20. And we're hearing, you know, anytime we're out talking to businesses or site selection consultants, not only in the U.S., but across the globe, the three key drivers are talent, talent, and talent. And every state that we compete with faces this same thing. So as we see the changes where, whether it's financial services or it's aviation aerospace, most of these now are not the normal industries we see. They're tech companies that have a focus on financial services or have a focus on manufacturing and aerospace. So it's finding those key those key areas of study that are going to be able to fill those gaps. Because if we can't do it, North Carolina can, Georgia can, Texas can, and will. So it is, to Ken's point, it's that partnership between the university system, between the state college system, between state agencies, and the private sector. We rely heavily on the private sector to tell us what the needs are. And I'll give you a good example. Recently, Citigroup, who has over 7,500 employees in the Tampa Bay market, were lacking in the area of advanced mathematics for some of their risk and compliance. Now they partner well with USF and well with UT on some of the AML and anti-money laundering. But for the mathematics, they went to UCF and had a discussion with one of the deans, and they now have produced a PhD program in mathematics tailored to what Citigroup's needs were. And now that spawns out to other folks in the private sector that can take advantage of the academia that these students will have coming out. So it's that type of ingrained partnership and really being vocal and knowledgeable and sharing all this as we go through this process.
So as we switch over to the education side, I'm going to ask the same question. When you think about workforce development, how would you define that, and is it different in any way from what you've heard from the business side?
I think I'd offer two things. One is it's absolutely not different, and if it was different, we'd be missing the target. And we're not listening to business community and what they expect, then we're producing degrees that don't match our economy and leaving our students short. One of the things that we have done in the university system now for the past 5 years is work around a set of what we call programs of strategic emphasis. These aren't what academics determine are the programs that we want to be involved in, but they're actually looking at the shortfall we see in degree production as we compare it to the demands of the job. And it's a fluid metric. It is one of those things that it's not just a STEM or a STEAM or a STEM with two M's kind of discussion. It's what do we see in terms of job demand in Florida versus degrees produced in Florida. I think the other thing that's probably sort of an admission against interest, we've got to stop recruiting everyone who breathes into the state university system. And we have to think about how we work with the college system, with other partners in higher ed, to best position a student to be successful. I think maybe by happenstance, our state stopped funding headcount in higher ed, and that was a recession thing, but it was also a good thing. And what we've tried to do is move more and more to an output-based, degree-based metric, so that we're not recruiting kids to help pay the bills, we're recruiting students who we believe we can be successful and get a degree and get a good job.
Charles, thank you for the question. I think I have two points that I'd like to raise. One, indeed, we have to be consistent with the market needs and what the employers are asking for. There is very little time that goes by when I'm not talking to an employer and they're not telling me what their needs are, because that's why we exist in large part. At least that's a big part of why we exist, to make sure we're feeding the needs of the market. But we're in a very interesting market right now, because in Broward County, right now we have a 2.8% unemployment rate. Obviously the state is at a blazing unemployment rate as well, under 4%, and we continue to do very well, thank goodness, from a state perspective. But what that also means is that employers who are continuing to grow are having a very difficult time finding employees or keeping employees. And so we have to start to look at where's the opportunity to match the needs that currently exists with the realities of the very low unemployment rates in our community. So one of the things that we started to do is notwithstanding the fact that we have a 2.8% unemployment rate, it starts to identify, are there still pockets of our community that are unexposed to whether it be post-secondary education, whether we have technical college, whether we have Broward College, or other opportunities for education. So what we saw was that there were, I think we counted now, 11 zip codes in Broward County with 10+% unemployment. Okay, and this is interesting because a lot of times you look at these zip codes, and if you're an outsider, you might be thinking, well, why aren't they employed? You know, are they lazy? Are they this? So what's the challenge there? A lot of times it's a matter of exposure. In fact, I've walked some of these neighborhoods and knocked on doors in some of these neighborhoods and started having conversations with folks. And a very unique conversation usually occurs, and I'll say, I'm the president of Broward College. I want you to know about the college of existence. And also, I want you to think about going to college in your community, thinking about going to college. And a gentleman says to me, and this is not an uncommon answer, I can't go to college. All I know how to do is fix motors, right? Not realizing that we have the automotive sector looking very heavily at trying to figure out how we're going to meet our workforce needs. Or we have aviation maintenance, and there's a huge need in that space as well, and that translates very well. So part of the job, inevitably, if we're going to meet the needs of our employees, particularly in this great market, not about what it continues, is making sure that we are drawing the bridge between the employer's needs and making the individual, the resident, who has the skill set, the aptitude, the ability, but just doesn't recognize the opportunity. So that's part of our job to do as well. The other thing is, once we actually get a student with us, we have about 63,000 students, so we have a lot of students. And the students that are with us, no matter how good of a job you do at saying, here's the job you're going to do, right, or be prepared for, we know we're going to be wrong 10 years out, right? Because the data tells us that the highest number I've seen is that 80% of the jobs that will exist don't exist today. Now, whether it's 50, 60, 70, or 80, it's a lot, right? And we can't prepare our students. There's two ways to think about that. One, we want to promote lifelong education. So a student, that doesn't mean staying in 10 years to get your degree, right? That means you're moving through programs, you recognize that circumstances will change in the market, you'll come back to school, maybe for short term, maybe for long term, whatever it may be, so you continue to be adjusted to the marketplace as it changes, because we can't anticipate those changes. But the other part, I would say this is even more fundamental to the educational process, is making sure that students, when they are with us, they are learning, no matter what subject it is, to have an entrepreneurial mindset, right? To be thinking about either what's around the bend, so they are not the subject of disruption or innovation, or perhaps they can anticipate it and adjust accordingly, or perhaps they're creating it, and regardless of what field you're in. So what we're doing now is looking at, we have a pathway now that are tied to workforce needs. So we have health sciences pathway, you imagine a nursing program being that. We have a public safety pathway, and so on and so forth. And regardless of the pathway you're in, contextualizing the learning around entrepreneurial mindset, right? Even a nurse may have tools that are displaced, or a role, or the position starts to look differently. And we want our nurses not only to be the best nurses, but to be prepared for the changes and to anticipate them in the marketplace. So as we continue to fully integrate our entrepreneurial experience and mindset together into the education system, we know not only are we preparing our students for a life that may look completely different 10 years from now, but when they're working for their employers now have a team that is also not just the CEO, not just the senior management team, but working to understand what the changes are coming and anticipate them appropriately.
I'm going to do another round of questions up here, and for Ken and Tim, how would you describe the state of our infrastructure today when it comes to workforce development? You know, what is the state of the system that we have, and then where are the jobs today, and where are the jobs likely to be in the future?
Sure. I think, from my standpoint, our state is evolving ecosystem. You know, the whole trade of business, education, and also government come together. And we've talked about it. You start seeing real, forward motion. I was in Fort Pierce yesterday, and Fort Pierce, beautiful community, but not many jobs. People are hurting. And I took a tour of the quarters of Fort Pierce, and there's a great project where the county reached out to the private sector to buy a portion of the fort and develop a business to repair yachts. And in Indian River and State College, receive a job growth grant fund from DEO and provide training for individuals.
individuals to work at this facility and create 850 good paying jobs for an area that was dependent on agriculture, that's faded, and people need jobs in that area that really matter and help them grow and develop life. So seeing that type of connection on the ground matters, and seeing that model replicated matters for our state. We're communicating and we're really having a strategic plan across the state. And for commercial boards, we have about 24 of them, they're really working hard and really penetrating the needs for our people at the same time. As we look at apprenticeships, university system, or just how we ensure that communities have the training they need for the future workforce, there needs to be more communication and more penetration. What do you think, sir?
What do you say?
I just made that up. Go ahead.
That's good. And I agree. I think, you know, a large component of this is our friends at Career Source, who do a fantastic job on supporting us in within those 24 boards. I think when you have a state as large and diverse as Florida, obviously we have 67 children you have to look after, and each one of them is different. When you look at the sectors we have across the state, it's tough to narrow down even by cluster. For some states you can say, here's your aviation aerospace cluster, here's your financial service, your IT, your life science. We have that on all four corners of the peninsula. So I think that's a good thing, right? That diversity for the economy is great, because we're not relying on just tourism, we're not relying just on manufacturing. So continuing that spread, if you will, across the whole state is extremely important. I think we do have to focus, similar to what the gentleman said earlier from the Pepin School, not everyone wants to go to college, wants to go to university, and that's okay, because we're seeing that we're short welders. We're short CNC operators. So these are important cogs of the wheel of any manufacturing operation, of any MRO operation, or an OEM operation. So really understanding and outlining a plan on how we partner together, and it all goes back to the partnership, communicating and understanding these things. And I think everyone else is kind of the same transition. We also have to be mindful of the earlier question of what is it going to look like in 2020 and so on and so forth. So as we're figuring out how this works, we still at the same time have to be able to ready and be able to pivot to what it's going to look like in the future.
So pivoting to education, we talked a little bit about the career retooling of folks with Career Source, apprenticeship programs. How does what does it mean for Florida to be number one eventually? That's the goal that the governor has set out, number one in workforce development education. And what is the unique space for the Florida University System, the Florida College System, as it's working both as a system and then in a region like Broward to get there?
Pausing for a minute, I want to pick, I forgot if I could put a plug in for the fact that we've been named in the third year in a row as the best state for post-secondary education, and I would know that that's the colleges that you're really best. But I think there's an important part of that. So if you look at those metrics, they are measuring attainment, which we talked about earlier, was the degree, was the attainment of some credential, high-value credential or degree after high school. Probably one of the areas that our state lacks. And so our opportunity, and frankly, now that we've got leadership from the top that is setting the goal for our state, that tends to lead to attainment of that goal, really is to better understand how we position ourselves with our students, with our employers, to create the sense of value for every student, for what it means if they do something beyond getting a high school diploma. You all heard a lot of statistics today, but one that kind of shocked me recently. Only about 63% of our high school graduates have what is considered to be a college-ready diploma from high school. And for minority students, that could be as low as 52%. And so when we talk about how we create an opportunity, I think we've got to be thinking, and this is what I believe is going to happen in this legislation, we have to think about the continuum of education all the way, maybe I might even say, David Lawrence from the room that bought me. This is really a pre-K through 20 discussion that I think our state needs to have about where our students go and what their opportunities are. I think there's also a need to better engage business and academics in a conversation. We started this a few years ago with a new portal and really a new campaign called Think Florida, a higher degree for business. And one of the simple parts of this was recognizing that if you're a business in Florida and you want to talk to one of our universities, for the public side alone, you had to go to 12 different websites. And so what we've created is a single portal where any business can go who is looking for an intern or an employee and actually connect. It's basically a drop-down menu. You can pick everybody. You can pick certain universities. You can give some information about what it is you're looking for, or you can pull some pre-selected categories. We're trying to simplify, you know, what a silly idea is to simplify the way for a business to reach out and tell the university what they need, and then the university in turn through its Career Resource Center to talk to its students about what's available to them. About 3 years ago. And if that's new news, then that's a failure on our part to adequately keep pushing that. It's think-florida.org is the website, and one of the elements in that is the portal connection. And so I think there's another side of this also is making sure, and I've struggled with, started thinking when you had to tell kids in ninth grade what they needed to know. And I thought about, no, you really got to tell them before they get to high school because everything counts starting in ninth grade. And I'm almost convinced now that you got to get down to about fifth to sixth, seventh grade. We need to be purposeful in our state about talking to students about what their opportunities are in the future and help them understand the economic consequence as well as the personal fulfillment. We talk a lot in academics about a feeling of enrichment and doing the things that you're interested in, but there's also a practical effect, and what do people pay for that? In the university system, we started, we're 5 years in now, we now produce a study every year. We just take the kids that graduate. We track where they are a year later. So we now can correlate. If you're getting this degree, people for five graduating classes, 5 years of graduation across 12 universities, we can now tell you, if you get this degree, people like you have gone to work in these industries. And in reverse, we can show you, if you're interested in these industries, because not everybody, apologies to the accountants in the room, but not every degree is linear. But if you're interested in going to work in a particular area, we can show you all the pathways that someone else has chosen along the way to get into that business. So we're trying to find, now again, this is selling university to, and that's where we've got to be thoughtful about how do we do this on a broader basis so that students and their families have some understanding of what are those things out there that people do for a living, and what are those jobs when we talk about a high value job or a fulfilling job. Are we thinking about in terms of personal security for someone? And how do we have that conversation so that it's not just a matter of what did my mom and dad do or what did somebody I know do? Can we somehow create a Florida community that understands what people who are interested in what you're interested in Florida have gone on to do these things? And then connect that to our employers as well so they know where to find the kids that have those.
So much to say about this, I feel like. You know, one of the things that our chancellor just mentioned was, you know, how far do you go down into the education system to have this conversation? I have two daughters. I have a three-year-old daughter and a seven-year-old daughter. And my seven-year-old daughter goes to a public elementary school. She's in the first grade. And we just moved into a neighborhood that we lived in just under a year ago. So it was in August of last year that I was taking her to school. First time I walked her into her building and walked her into her classroom. But before you enter her classroom, if you look above the threshold of her door, you would see the mascot and the name of a college above her door in the first grade. And you look at every single doorway and above every single threshold is a different college or university identified. And so this school is making it impossible for these children not to already see some symbols of their post-secondary future, right? And so, and probably because of who her father is, but my three-year-old even can tell you a couple of colleges that she'd be thinking about going to already. And so part of it is these factors that are created by the communities as well. But if we're thinking about the state, as I'm so glad and pleased that our governor is working on failing 60. He's done already so much to try to make this a salient point of view for our state. You know, one of the things, so I'll touch on two things. I'm saying the fact that I think there are a lot of things to talk about here, but the two things I'll talk about in that regard is as Broward College exists, we are an open access institution, as our Florida State College system. So we are the gateway in many ways to post-secondary education. Many of our students come in just for remedial education, and our job in many ways is to help them catch up and get them either to the workforce or to our university system. And we do those things very well as a state, for sure, and certainly at Broward College. And so we have been always thinking about how to create that access. Right? I talked to you a little bit about some of the community that may not be thinking about this, but have the talent to be successful and understand it. Another way is dual enrollment, and that's an area that's growing significantly statewide. So for those who don't know, dual enrollment is essentially where students can both go to high school and take college-level coursework contemporaneously, even to the extent of getting a college degree, an associate's degree, days before or within days of getting their high school diploma. And so there are certain rigidities to this, right? You have to have certain criteria, you have to have a certain grade point average. And so one of the things that we've talked about during this past session and out of the DOE being very supportive of is the potential for loosening some of the standards to create more opportunities, and particularly in workforce areas. And so not to get too esoteric, but when you're seeking an associate's degree at that level, the high school level, it's considered a higher threshold. You have to have at least a 3.0. But if you're getting a workforce degree, speaking to attainment, you can have a lower GPA, have a 2.5, and you can get some of the folks who can fill the need from an aviation maintenance and all these other areas as well. And so driving that agenda, which the state did, I think, a great job, and we are in the college system as well, creating more dual enrollment opportunities in the workforce space, which lends itself to the attainment needs of the state, very, very valuable. These students end up getting certificates. And we launched a program, our first one in August of last year at Broward College. It was an aviation maintenance program. Students would get a certificate in either 1 or 2 years. Had 33 students, a third of them were young women, which is very unusual in the aviation space. And it's been fantastic. They've all done incredibly well. Many of them are first generation college students. And they all passed. They all did very well and are getting certificates. And we already have employment for them as well. And so this ties into that specific need. The other point I'll talk about, and this did not pass in the legislative session, but I don't think it made it into the train on education, but the governor had the foresight to inject what he called, I think it was fight to the finish or getting to the finish line. Bottom line is we have a lot of folks in the state of Florida who have some post-secondary education but have not received a certification or a degree. And really the worst case scenario is that someone spends the time, resources, and doesn't get anything on the back end of it. And so what he had proposed, although it didn't get budgeted, unfortunately, but what he had proposed was that if we could identify folks in the last few years who are maybe 10 to 12 credits away, can we go get those folks, fund them, and then move them through the certification? And I'll just give you one quick story about that. I was actually out with my wife on a date once, and we go to dates more than once, but on this one particular day. On this particular occasion, we were out and we were on a very busy street in Broward County. And I walked into a venue, a restaurant, and someone looks at me and comes up to me and she says to me, this must be a gift from God, right? And she's sitting next to me. And I don't know what she's talking about. Obviously, I tell my wife I don't know what she's talking about. And so she says it again, and turns out she's very upset. And she's a student of ours. And she says, I have one class left to take. I should premise this with the fact that it costs $114 per credit to go to Broward College. Tuition and fees, $114. She says, I have one class to take before I get my degree, and I'm running out of financial aid. And that was a Friday. I told her to email me the message that night. It was the following Monday. I worked with my team over the weekend, let them know. The following Monday, we were able to find some emergency dollars to get her the $300 to finish her degree. All right. And I think about, I'm very pleased that happened, right? but I think about how many students do I not run into? And they run into this challenge and they never get back in, right? And so that, you think about our future, right? That there are a lot of folks in that situation. And again, I thank the governor for raising this issue, and going back and getting those folks will help us get to 60.
The worst part, right, Greg, is that people often have tens of thousands of dollars in debt without the benefit of the degree.
Definitely.
But you're absolutely right.
I think they call it the last mile.
The last mile. That's what it was. The last mile.
So at this point, I want to turn it over to all of you to hear what you've heard, what kind of questions you've got. What's the role of the private sector in some of the conversations that we've had with the education leaders, the government, and industry leaders? Any advice you may have for Tax Watch? We're going to start with Steve.
Sure. Charles, first of all, thank you very much. For those that are involved in the private sector, please support your security in all the right points. The question I think that is as complex as far as this is what happens to how can we bring Tim, I agree totally with you. We are partners in manufacturing and transfer. We all see that in our field. And it also can issue giant jobs and students.
That's right.
You said that, and we can see that every day. Let me ask you a question. There's one area that's confusing to some of us. I don't know. A couple of us are in Japan. We realize the state's divided into different regions and the needs of one are not necessarily the needs of another. So think of Panhandle. The difference if you start to role and responsibility of BOTEX versus community colleges in terms of workforce development. If we stay home, we see common. And that resolution is
pretty impressive. Sure. Yeah, no, I think it's a great point. I think that we're, and so first of all, you're not alone in that, right? There are a lot of folks who we need some disaggregation there and how to talk about what these are and what the different components are. And it does depend on where you are regionally. So we have three technical colleges in our community. We have to work very, very closely with them. In fact, we work so closely that we decide whether or not we want to offer programs based on whether or not our technical college will offer programs. I'll give you a perfect example. We have culinary in South Florida, and throughout Florida we have local business, but certainly in South Florida is a huge industry. And so we actually don't offer a culinary program as you might see it typically, right? We don't have the kitchen, we don't do all those things. Why? Well, our local technical colleges will support the culinary programs, and we actually have FIU, which supports culinary programs as well. So we go, well, the technical colleges are doing some of this, the FIU is doing some of this. There's really no place for us to be doing this. We don't need to. We're great partners in a lot of different ways, transfer partners, certainly. And what we started to do, because the Department of Education is working very closely with this, as they should, Commissioner Corcoran, is looking at kind of an auditing of what are the assets from a technical college to a community college or state college perspective through the university perspective. And so when he did that, I said, let's self-audit and see where that is. And so we did the self-audit, it looks great for us, and so we're all, Commissioner, let's work on it together, let's figure it out. But it depends on where you are from a regional perspective, so the confusion could be significant or it may not be. But it really does depend on what the partnership service is. But probably the most important thing to share with you is not only that you're not alone, but the state is looking at it, and I think that's the right thing to do, no question. Particularly when you're talking about the tax, Florida tax not what we can do, taxpayer resources, right? And making sure there's no duplication around some of these programs, and even, you know, and so it's good to take a look at it and make sure that the transition goes in position.
I have one other question for you on that. What do you see, what we see from up there is a tremendous drive to technology. There's a significant amount of wanting entrepreneurialism and startups. In Panhandle, there's a lot of startup community entrepreneurialism, so I think it's never been in the last 20 years. It's all revolving around the idea of development, skills, tools, the whole lab. Acceleration is going on in that area right now. On the opposite end of the spectrum, the direct, especially the effects of Irving Michael,
think, you know, connection, business, government, education, so we should put money in this area for the future. One thing I've done since I got to the DEO, we put about $3 million in the real infrastructure and workforce development. I developed in Jackson County a program for building construction because we realized that we need that training for those people. But at the same time, the money we get for Michael, who I have for Herman, it's not going to repair and replace houses, but go to workforce training and put the money in workforce training activities in that matter. So, you know, that balance of the future and the present, ensuring that working careers are identified in that given region, because you guys said, Florida's a panhandle, Central is the boot, all right, it's the bottom. But where we make sure that there's a coherent plan to help the state grow in industries that will allow individuals, whether you have a high school diploma, and you have a certificate, or a college degree, you get that training in that area of school. So that's what we're doing at DEO.
I think we had a question from Matt McKinnon.
Yes, I just wanted to say maybe part of the council 771 did put back in some career education back in the K-12 system, which was very much needed. And also just took out some certifications and replaced math and science. I think
those are would y'all mind seeing this, Mike? You guys are so smart. I can't hear a word you're saying.
I was just saying that it was nice this year to see House Bill 771 get passed, where it did put in some legislation that allows K-12 students, particularly those in high school, to exchange career certification with a math and science requirement for graduation, and then it instilled some career exploration requirements for 6th through 8th graders as well. So I commend that. I thought it was a great direction. I have noticed, and then correct me if I'm wrong, and heard that we have, not correct me, but we have a great college institution and our college graduates are coming out, but we also have a great deal of them leaving Florida once they come in. So I was just curious if you all have experienced that, or if that's a true aspect that our college graduates are coming to Florida, they're getting these great degrees, and then they're leaving. And if so, what can we do to stop that? Because we're losing our greatest asset when it comes to something like that.
I'd actually say statistically, no, they're not. Across the board, and I would say that in certain degree areas that are competitive, or highly competitive, particularly like engineering as an example, frankly, the fact that employers in other states pay more is probably one of the major reasons. You know, what we don't see is a group of engineering graduates who can't find jobs. It's that they have three or four offers. It's almost that, frankly, at certain levels, you see the same challenge on our enrollment side is we see students who are the most competitive students are getting multiple offers around the country to go to school in the first place. So I think that what we work at, and we do track it, and we watch it. It's also interesting, I guess, from a family's perspective, if their child gets a good job, they're not as worried about where it is as we might be worried about where it is. But I think that, you know, and that's not saying just get a lot and raise wages, but I think one of the things that we see is that's one of the factors that attracts them. We have been able, during the last several years, probably 6 years now, we can track our graduates as to where they end up in their first job or where they go if they continue their education. And we're able to look at it by degree and get some sense of that. But overall, I think you're hearing a lot more. There's probably more noise in that than there's reality. That doesn't mean it's not important. I think there's an issue for all of us. DEO, to me, is the pivot point on this. They have good statewide data. Their good statewide data disaggregates to regional data. Said differently, I think it's actually regional data is aggregated up to statewide data. And so we have the ability to understand our state, and when we're driven by the real numbers, it sort of drives us to make the right decisions about taking investments. I often assume everybody's heard of it before, but I guess I'll add on to the comment that was made earlier too. Florida was the first state to really have a 2+2 plan where our colleges, you know, we have a pathway for our students to go from a college to a university. I think our challenge on the university level going forward still is to understand colleges are our partners. Close to half of our upper division, juniors and seniors, don't come, you know, come from somewhere else, and most of that is from the college system, so that we are working for it mostly now. And I think we've got, you know, in my dream world, we would get down to the level of understanding sort of what's the propensity to be mobile of a student based on where they are in the state. And there are differences. You know, if you think about it, if a kid goes to UF, FAMU, or FSU, they probably aren't all coming from Alachua and Leon County. Those are, I would argue, probably, if you thought about this from a customer perspective, those are probably more mobile people. Then someone who may go, careful, I don't pick on something. Let's say somebody went to Florida Gulf Coast University. They may be more oriented towards Southwest Florida. Our college students are probably more locally focused. And so I think as we get really graceful about this, we start thinking about not only what do I create on a regional basis, what do I create on a statewide basis, and what's the probability that I have the right mix of people who want jobs in that area. And if we got really good at it and thought about it enough, we would probably get to the point where we could understand that we might want to put some sticky incentives in certain parts of the state, because you might be suffering as much from a kid in Southwest Florida going to Orlando to get a job as you are a kid going to the deal. And I apologize for all those who are students and our kids, but you know, I guess I'm going to have a disappointment.
Hey, Charles, can I say something real quick? I'm sorry.
Just real quick, this bill on something that Marshall said. In my house, we have a lot of data. And one of my biggest projects I have challenged people is how do we weaponize that data? We have information on how money we spend in terms of grants and loans, right? And also what's happening in terms of requests, and then, but it's not really compiled in a way that's usable. So I've asked my stats team to come together and create a website so we and also our partners can utilize it. So we'd be more proactive city funds now, looking at workforce, and even more an active partner, which is the asset where folks are asking for grants and loans. So ensuring the data is marshaled and used is really important for my organization.
Okay, I'll be brief just to answer the question I've raised, at least as it relates to the colleges. So nearly all of our students actually stay in the local region, right? Particularly those who are getting workforce degrees. But remember, conceptually, we are designed to meet those local workforce needs. So we have the goal of ensuring, and our students have the goal of ensuring, that they're getting a great job upon graduation, job placement rate for our workforce degree oriented students at around 90% or so, which is great, and the pay is fantastic as well. And so, but they're feeding global workforce needs, so they're nearly all of them saying that they increase that for the system as well.
Hi. Thanks. I really appreciate that you actually went to the communities and started talking with people. And so you are doing education around workforce development and going into the community and just letting folks know that, hey, here's an opportunity for you. Do any of your colleagues and others in other community colleges or the technical colleges, are they doing similar outreach like that? Because I think that for years and years, you know, we've been teaching our children and the generation, my generation and others, is when you graduate from high school, you got to college,
right?
And we do know that not everyone is college material. Chancellor Kreiser just said that not everybody is, you know, wanting to go to college, but they've been pressured to go to college. So do you all work, all right, so my question is two-pronged. One, are your colleagues at the other community colleges or technical colleges taking that same kind of proactive, go out and communicate with people? And then my second question goes to the Career Force Centers. Do you all collaborate with them to kind of push people into those positions that are available or get them trained for the positions that are available?
So I think it's a great question. So it's going to sound like I'm being evasive, but I'm not. Okay, so that's all right. So there's wonderful research by a gentleman by the name of Rosh Chetty. Rosh, in front of me, for his name, Rosh Chetty is the youngest tenured Harvard professor of economics in the nearly 400 year history of Harvard. And he has an online platform that's fantastic. It's called the Opportunity Atlas. And so if you go into this platform, you can dial, type in any zip code in America, and it will tell you the lifetime earning outcomes based on being from that zip code. And so Dr. Chetty and I have been working together for the last 8 or so months. Because he has a policy side of this, and you know, and I'll just be very frank with you. If, in my view, if your zip code is the most prominent determinant of your income outcomes, we have a massive problem. And we also, I'm assuming also us around this table, recognize that post-secondary education of some sort, whether it be a certificate, whether it be an associate's degree, a baccalaureate degree, and certainly as you get to professional degree attainment, has an impact on your income. And so, to your point around, you know, any given neighborhood being able to tell their kids or tell their community, you know, go to college, you have to be more descriptive, I think, about what those options are, right? It is not necessarily an associate's degree. It's not necessarily a bachelor's degree. It certainly isn't necessarily a law degree, which might have a higher level of attainment. But there are great jobs and great opportunities out there at different levels, depending on your circumstances. Now, if you do this really well, in my view, we have what we call laddering programs, where particularly for first-generation college students, they may be afraid of the idea of going to college. 4 years, I can't do that, or I have a family, or I'm working, or my friends say I can't do it, or my teacher in high school said you're not good enough. And so then you take one class, and you say, you pitch them with something like, hey, there's a certificate in 6 months that will get you from $15 an hour to $25 an hour. Okay, maybe I can try that one, right? Now, these certificates, the way we built them, in other paths too, is laddering into degrees, right? So you get a certificate, you say, oh, I can do this, another 6 months, you do that, another 12 months before you know you have your associate's degree. We've had a lot of success with that, right? Opening up the door. Now, your question around whether or not our partners are doing this, the reason why I met with Chetty is because what we decided to do is we're actually going into the neighborhood, not just having a conversation and knocking on doors, but we're partnering with local assets of the community. So for example, we have, obviously, you all probably have them in your backyard, so very underutilized library systems, right? Very few people are going to the libraries now, so for example, we're partnering with our library system. We have 37 libraries in Broward County, one in each, at least one in each of our 31 municipalities, where we're providing educational opportunities there. The Boys and Girls Clubs in those communities. Boys and Girls Clubs are strategically located in low-income communities. Low-income, which really means higher unemployment, lower post-secondary attainment rates. Right, and so what we're doing is bringing those opportunities to those communities. That piece, and talking to Raj Chetty and others, we have not seen any other model. We're about a year into doing this. We haven't seen other models like this. And so I can't say that I know of other institutions that are doing it. But we've already, for example, we've gone in one of our most challenged corridors, and since August, we've been able to serve 700 new students, right? Because they're not coming to, if you know Los Solos, which is our, you know, version of Fifth Avenue, if you will, right? And so bringing it to those communities has started to make a difference.
One caution I'd offer also, I'll speak only for the universities. Asking a university president to expose a potential student to all the things that are available to them, it could kind of be like asking, can you recruit businesses to Georgia? And that when a student, we don't just say no. Learned how to do is talk about pathways for students, particularly through the colleges. And what's most exciting to me, so under 2+2, we have this sort of general offer that if you get an Associate of Arts at a college, you have an opportunity to get to a state university. But what's even more exciting is how colleges and universities develop pathway programs, particularly where we've identified an area in a college where we're not getting enough recruits. Even the University of Florida has a particular pathway with one of the colleges in Southwest, on the west coast of Florida, where they are recruiting not just into engineering, but specific degrees within engineering, civic, whatever, where they see a short pipeline. Doing a better job of helping that student say, if you go here, if you complete these things, you're not a you can apply and think about it, but creating that vision for a student from the front end if what they want to do is achieve that outcome, rather than probably pass the answer to no and we'll rely on you to go figure out where else you apply. But as a state, I would say somehow with the business community, we have to find a way to communicate to young people the value of a job. My data is old, but I still use it. It's it's only about 5% a day. At AT&T, in a retail store, you don't have to have a college degree to get hired into a site of the retail store. That job paid a minimum of $40,000 a year. You could make up to $70,000 a year. If you were doing pretty good, you made $50,000 a year. That's not a bad job. Now, out of that group of 12 or so employees, we were looking for one or two employees that could become the manager of that office. At that level, you may need education. But thinking about how to get a foot in the door and help a student think about that and what they might build with. And then I think our other challenge is going to be this whole area of taking credentials or experience and translating them into the shorthand of academics. And in some ways, you as business leaders, you benefit from the same thing. If you hire someone with a degree in finance, you sort of expect that they have a basic set of skills. That's shorthand for you, it's shorthand for us. How do we translate someone who's actually been involved in, you know, making sure the budget balances or in some kind of transaction, giving them credit? It's going to be a big lift. I don't think this actually survived this year. You know, one of them, I lost track. You know, there was one proposal where we would offer certain credits to individuals that served in the military. What, if I'm wrong that it didn't survive, correct me. But you know, what's exciting about that is at least we're taking one segment of the economy and focusing on it and saying, translate activity to credential to degree. And if we do that one time, we can do it 100 times. We've got to do it the first time to figure out what the rules are so that we do it right.
So, Ryan, did you have a question earlier?
No, he actually answered about reaching out to nonprofits, but that was awesome.
So we've got about 4 minutes of Charles.
Sure. I wanted to follow up on Matt's question and he left out, because my experience has been just at the higher income. So Chancellor, my experience of all of my friend groups that are, I went to Florida and that are over $100,000, the overwhelming majority all the way up north, right? They don't live in the state. And so, Kim, when you talk about the holy trinity of government and business and education, coming from Illinois, coming from Chicago, I felt like Florida should be like Texas or Texas, California, New York, these other large peer states, but our economy is different. So I'm wondering, is there any collaboration around that trend, the whole trend that you mentioned in the plan to say, how do we create high income industry like these other states so that this peer group not only leaves, but they're like, there's no way I'm coming back because there's no opportunity for me except for a handful. And even me, most of my, the overwhelming majority of my income comes from outside the state. So is there collaboration around that in creating and nurturing those industries?
Well, I think you may be two sessions late, because like that got makes a question about incentives. And you know, how much we put out there to bring a big company to Florida that may be located somewhere else and get some type of tax break or some benefit. We had a discussion, you know, this in 17, where your life has changed, same with this in Florida. And, you know, with the, we've talked about training, right, the discussion, politicians, are they really buying into what's necessary for, say, some type of multinational or some type of national company to relocate in Florida, which will pay higher salaries in a given area? Maybe so, maybe not. But without those incentives, without that building discussion and appreciation, we're going to lose out. Am I right about that, Steve? All right. But then, beyond that, looking at, you know, what's our competitive advantage as a state? What companies will come to buy virtually we do have involved? Then, do we have a good education system? Do we have people who are trained up? And do we have, like, say, more taxes and other benefits and less regulation? You make an argument that perhaps we bring some new type of company here. Maybe not bigger ones if we have those incentives, but we'll have some of that. But that comes down to having that place there to pay a higher salary. So when you fish for a Florida State, or say, Tampa Community College, and there's a specialized skill set, get that higher salary. But that company has to be there. And we have to be in agreement about what it takes to bring those companies in versus engaging in theory.
Charles?
That's the same thing.
Sorry.
Oh, thank you.
I do want to, first of all, thank each of you all for your service in the state of Florida. It's been excellent, too. We've Texas recently did a report on our college system again, show the great value of the taxpayers of Florida getting and our students. Very true. Marshall did the same thing, probably not much different because of what USC is in World War. Congratulations on three-peat.
So,
four-peat. My question is, and Marshall and I have talked about this repeatedly, both as our chairman and tax auction, but now in your capacity. We graduate far too many of our doctors and particularly medical personnel. And, opportunities going to knock, and they're going to go across state lines, either in Philly or in California and so forth. But talk a little bit about what some of the things we can do better to ensure we have residencies and internships and those kind of opportunities that align them with. We have great demands in our own state for particularly primary care physicians. And maybe paying down their student loans, that would be a big deal. But what are some of the things we can do that would be good strategies that tax office can work with you, Marshall, and
state board? I'll get shot for this answer, if that's okay. I think one thing that would help, and I've tried to dabble with this a little bit, is we ought to figure out whether it would be cheaper to create more residencies or cheaper to come up with some kind of incentive to recruit doctors who are graduating from some other state. The reality is, I think, I could argue for more residencies because we are a state where healthcare is going to be, when we talk about jobs, healthcare. We need more nurses. We've needed more nurses since I was 17 years old, and I worked in an osteopathic hospital, and one wing of the third floor was converted to housing to bring nurses in from outside the country. So we think, if somebody says we needed nurses for 10 years, no, we've needed them for 40 plus years. We've got to think about how to recruit and retain. I think you've got to do both. The reality is students, when they graduate, are going to go to the place that jingles their bell, whether that's a salary, whether that's the working for the best, as they might define it. But we also have to be thoughtful about, are there economic incentives also drive behavior? And so I think some work to really think about what's the best approach, whether it's finding a way to sign policies and I would say not just, it's not, I'm kind of a believer, you got to really get down to it and figure out, we need doctors in certain areas who will live in certain areas, not just every doctor who wants to move to Florida or every doctor who graduates from Florida. It's kind of a perennial, and I think for our state, Dominic and I had this conversation years ago, is healthcare a cost or a revenue source, they say, for, I think in the long term, it probably is a revenue source if we get it right. Because that's what people want to live here, and we need to make them comfortable living here. I haven't answered your question, so I'm really, I keep struggling. I got a lot of med students who will tell you we need more licenses. But the reality is, students are driven. If you want to study heart, there are places you go. Some of them are in Florida, but many of them are not, and it won't matter. But
part of our care is along with your
unfortunately, it's not cheap. You gotta do something. You gotta have enough spaces for them to stay, but you've gotta give them something more than just a residency to do. I think the issue, it's interesting. I mean, student debt in Florida is actually not the problem that is nationally. So we've got to be careful that we don't overreact to it. Actually, with that number one rating, one of the reasons we do so well is our student debt is relatively low. One of the reasons our student debt is relatively low is our tuition is some of the lowest in the country. But there are challenges, and you have to be thinking about what are the triggers and how to pull them and who pulls them.
So our time here this afternoon is coming to a close, since our reception is about to start. So I want to, before we close, I'm going to let each of our panelists say just anything that they have not been able to get out, and or one piece of advice that they would have for Florida Tax Watch, thinking about workforce development and either research, or policy levers, advocacy, anything that they would like to contribute. So we'll start it down with Craig.
Sure. I think
I'll just say, I'd like to come back to your question around, you know, what can we do to be more attractive to folks. So, as prideful as we all are and should be about having the number one public post-secondary education system in the nation, I still, this is going to sound cheap and cliche, but I just think it's true, we don't say enough about it. You know, we don't talk about it. It should be front page news in New York and Boston, especially during the winter. I mean, it should be something that we tout, because when folks are relocating, you know, part of the reason, you know, you'll see a lot of us involved with our workforce leadership, obviously, both locally and statewide, because one of the biggest questions, and the K-12 component of it too, one of the biggest questions is, what's the education system going to be like? And number one, for the kids, but number two, for my workforce, right? And so the post-secondary component of our existence is just is tremendous, but we don't, in my view, talk about it nearly enough. I think even Florida residents are hearing about it for the first time every year, and even more importantly, maybe some Florida residents are even surprised by it. I think it's something we have to figure out a better way to own it